Welcome to this second video on building a better 3D model of a helicopter. And by better, I mean better than the first one that I created on this channel. The goal of this project is to create a realistic 3D model of a helicopter that I can use as a teaching aid for future videos on helicopter aerodynamics and control. And what you see on the screen is intended to be a Sikorsky Blackhawk helicopter, and I chose the Blackhawk because of the large amount of public source technical data, mostly in the form of NASA technical reports that are available online. And all of those reports are linked in the description if you're interested. At the end of the first video, I left you with what you see on the screen here. So this is the main gearbox, the input modules, and the tail rotor drive shaft. As of this second video, I've now modeled the main rotor, the intermediate gearbox, the intermediate drive shaft, and the tail rotor gearbox. But the main rotor is still a work in progress. I really need to model the flight controls and the swash plates before finalizing some of the things on the main rotor. Things like the location of the pitch change arms and the offset of the pitch change horn. Today's video will focus on the main transmission. And I'll cover three things in this video. In the first part, I'll go over the principles of operation. This will include the sizing of the gears and the gear reductions and gear ratios. Then I'll show the workflow that I used to create this in computer-aided design. In the last part of this video, I'll show the process of importing those CAD files into Blender and then rigging this for animation using the equations of motion of the gears. The purpose of a helicopter's main gearbox is to take high RPM power from the engines and turn that into low RPM power for the main and tail rotors. These two NASA reports led me to this basic schematic of the drive system and also to the gear parameters shown in the table. The color conventions in the schematic are the same that I used in the 3D model. All of the colors indicate a specific RPM. Any parts that have the same color are turning at the same speed. This helicopter transmission uses a three-stage gear reduction. The first stage starts with the engine output at 21,000 RPM, and the last stage ends at 258 RPM delivered to the main rotor. The first stage reduction happens between the engine input shaft, colored here in purple, and the input gear shown in blue. And the math for this stage is easy. To get the output RPM, multiply the input RPM by the gear ratio. So this is 21,000 multiplied by 22 over 80. And that results in the blue-colored shaft turning at 5,700 RPM. The second stage reduction happens between the blue pinion and the red-colored bevel gear. The bevel gear also combines the input power of both engines into one source of power for the transmission. Again, the math is straightforward, so the input RPM of 5,700, we multiply that by the gear ratio of 17 over 81, and this results in the bevel gear turning at 1,200 RPM. The final stage of reduction in this gearbox is the planetary gear, and this is slightly more complicated than the two simple bevel gears. There are three colors involved in this gear reduction, red, green, and brown, and each of those shows a different RPM in the planetary gear. This will be easier to see if I toggle the visibility of some of the components. So now I'm showing just the bevel gear and the sun gear. These two gears are connected by a shaft and they turn at the same speed of 1200 RPM. Now I'll hide the shaft and the bevel and just show the sun, the planets, and the ring. I think it should be easy to see why they call this thing a planetary gear set. It's very similar to our own solar system. The sun rotates on its own axis, and the planets have two rotations. They rotate on their own axis, but they also orbit around the sun. In the planetary analogy, our planet rotates about its own axis faster than it rotates about the sun's axis. For the Earth, this is 24 hours on our axis versus 1 year orbit around the sun's axis. In the case of the planetary reduction gear that you see on the screen, it's 709 RPM for the planet rotation versus 258 RPM for the planet orbit. The planetary system results in three rotation speeds: the rotation of the sun gear, the rotation of the planets on their own axis, and the orbit of all of the planets about the sun's axis. I'm not sure if this makes it easier to see, but I've added three rotation vectors using that same color convention showing the three different rotation speeds in the planetary gearbox. So with that basic understanding of a planetary reduction gear, that the planets rotate on their own axis and they orbit the sun, it's the planet's orbit rotation that we're interested in. This is the slowest of the three rotation speeds, and that's what we want to deliver to the main rotor. What is not shown on the screen right now is a way of getting that rotation out of the planetary orbits and into the rotor mast, and we need a device called a planet carrier to do this. The planet carrier connects to the five planet gears, and this takes the power output from the bottom of the gearbox and passes it through an internal shaft that rotates inside of the sun gear to the top of the gearbox. I'll just briefly jump over to the CAD and turn on the section view to show this better. This shows that shaft within a shaft and how the power of the planetary orbit is transferred inside of the bevel gear shaft and to the rotor mast. Calculating the gear reduction of a planetary gear is a little bit more complicated than the bevel gears that we showed earlier. Remember that I showed three separate rotation speeds within the planetary gears. And here are the three equations of motion for those three RPMs, all expressed with the main rotor RPM as the independent variable. And I did that. I used the main rotor RPM as the independent variable because when I get to the animation, what I'm looking for is that I have a single rotation controller for the entire helicopter. So I start the main rotor RPM turning, and every other gear in the helicopter is going to be based off of the equation of motion for that gear. In part three of this video, I'll show how I took those equations and put them into Blender to control the motion that you see on the screen. So that's it for the theory of operation of this helicopter main gearbox. We talked about the gear reductions, the three reduction stages, and we showed how we take input power of two engines turning at 21,000 RPM into a main rotor turning at 258 RPM. In the next part of this video, I'm going to talk about the computer-aided design of the main transmission. The CAD software that I use is Autodesk Fusion. And within Fusion, I'm going to start with the gear table that I created and showed earlier, and I'll enter all of the parameters for these gears into one of the free gear making add-ons that's available for Fusion. For the planetary gear, I used a tool called Helical Gear Plus. I created the sun, the planet, and the ring gear using those parameters, and then I created a sketch of the pitch circles for each of these gears in the planetary set. This sketch then formed the joint base for those gears. The rest of that geometry was fairly simple, basically some cylinders and revolves that connected those planetary gears to the upper rotor mast. Now the portion of the transmission that you see on the screen, that's one of many assembly files. You can imagine a helicopter is a complicated thing, and there are going to be many parts and many assembly files that all need to get merged into one. In the first video in this series, I showed how I created that base helicopter assembly file, the one that had no parts in it, that only had reference geometry. So my next step now is going to be to take that transmission assembly file and to drag it into the base assembly file and then join it to that reference geometry. And if you're wondering why I only have one planet gear, this is to simplify the animation workflow. A single gear will allow me to apply all of the rotation and motions to that gear, and then I can do linked duplicates within the animation software, and all of that work will be copied over. So instead of having to set the rotation equations five times, I only need to do it once. Once you're ready to send this file to Blender, you simply have to select File, Export, then Export as a 3MF or a 3D manufacturing file. There are quite a few different options you can export in. You can export as an OBJ, an FBX, or an STL file. I tend to prefer 3MF. So now we'll move over to Blender and import that 3MF file that we just created in the CAD into Blender for the animation. So Blender does not have a native add-on for importing 3MF files, but there is one available online and it's free. If you're searching for this online, the name is Blender 3MF Format. And you can see once you have that file installed, it's fairly simple to import this into the software. Once I do the import, I go through kind of a ritual to set everything up for the next step of the animation. The first thing I do is I apply the scale. I set all of the origins to the geometry, shade auto smooth. I enter edit mode and convert as many of the tries to quads as possible. This is to reduce the size of the meshes. And sometimes if I get the sense that some of the meshes aren't clean, that they have junk vertices in them, I'll do a merge vertices by distance to collapse some of the geometry. And then for a large assembly file in Blender, it's fairly important to move all of the items into collections and then also name the items. Naming can be fairly laborious. Moving them into collections is probably more critical than entering the names. It would be nice if the 3MF format were to import the names from the CAD software, but it doesn't do that. So to set up the gear motions for the planetary, I'm going to create a single rotation controller. And this is going to be the only keyframe in the model.
So to do this, I'll add an empty below the gearbox, and then I'll keyframe this to rotate. Let's do 360 degrees over something like 1800 frames. So this rotation controller, this rotation empty, will be the main rotor RPM, so I'll name that main rotor rotation. So now going back to those equations of motion for the planetary gear set, I'll start with just the sun gear. I want this equation to drive the sun gear, so I'll add a driver to make that happen, and set the input variable to the main rotor rotation controller that I just created. And now I just enter that equation into the expression field within the driver editor. Now when I start the animation, you're going to see that the sun gear rotates at an appropriate speed in relationship to the main rotor. The planet gear rotation is slightly more involved. Remember, each of these gears has two rotation axes. They rotate about their own axes and then also about the axis of the sun. So first I'll add an empty for the planet axis rotation and parent the gear and the bearings to that empty. The first rotation I'll add is the orbit around the sun. This is the equation that I said was trivial. Because the planet gear orbits the sun at the main rotor RPM, the equation is simple and it doesn't need a driver. Instead, I just parent the planet's rotation empty to the main rotor rotation controller. When I start the animation, you see the planet is orbiting around the sun, but because I haven't created its own axis rotation yet, it's not staying in mesh with the sun gear. To add that rotation, I need to add this equation of motion to drive the planet's empty. Once that's done, and I toggle the visibility of the ring gear, you can see that all of the gears within the planetary are staying in mesh while the animation is playing. But there's only one planet gear, and we need five. Before copying this gear, I'll first ensure that the transform pivot point is set to 3D cursor, and that the 3D cursor is at the center of the gearbox, which is the world origin in this case. Then I'll duplicate the gear, the bearings, and the rotation empty, and then rotate about the Z-axis by 72, which is 360 divided by 5 planet gears, and then repeat that action 3 more times. Now, when playing the animation, you can see all 5 gears are rotating properly and they're staying in mesh. Alright, now that I've covered the internal gears inside of the main gearbox, I'll go ahead and add back the other components, the input modules, the engine input shaft, and the tail rotor drive shaft, and just briefly play the animation. A few things that I haven't covered are the tail rotor drive shaft that takes power off the top of the bevel gear, and I haven't covered these bucket-looking things on the input modules. Those are referred to as freewheeling units. And unlike the last model I did, I've actually modeled the internal workings of the freewheeling units, and I'll explain those in a future video. Remember, the goal of releasing incremental videos is to use viewer feedback to help make this project better. I'm attempting to make this as realistic as possible to create a teaching aid for future videos about aerodynamics and rotor control, and very much look forward to hearing the comments and seeing what I can do to make this thing better. Thanks very much for watching.